It is God's word that tells us that God sings over us. And I'm so fortunate to be part of a church that has so many beautiful voices in it. We could hear God sing to us in such a beautiful way. And I'm just really, really blessed by that. So I just want to thank those who give their time and their talent to come let God speak to us through their voices. I really appreciate that. Well, it's good to be back. I want to thank Pastor Steve for coming last week, and I know he did a great job. He's a wonderful friend of mine. Blessed to have him at any time. Just give him a call, and he pops in. And so I'm thankful for him and his wife coming and all of his congregation coming and hanging out with us. And so I really appreciate that. But it's good to be back here. Why don't you do me a favor, and we just read the Bible around here. So why don't we just go ahead and grab a Bible and open it up to Matthew 16 is kind of where we're going to start off. But while you're turning there, just let you know there's Bibles everywhere. So if you don't have one, just pick up an orange or a yellow one. And some of the verses that we'll read from the scriptures tonight will be up on the screen. Just the reference, not the actual stuff. I want you to read a Bible. Anyway, last week I wasn't here because I was up in Chicago. And I went to a conference up there called Harvest University. And it was an amazing experience. A big part of that amazing experience is I got to stay with Kyle and Jamie, which was really neat. It's good to see them. I got to visit their new church where Kyle's the worship leader. Beautiful place, great bunch of people, super friendly. They seem to really love the Lord. They're very serious about the gospel going forth in their community. So that was great, and got to hear him do his thing. They did a great job. But I got to go to Harvest Bible Chapel up in Rolling Meadows, Illinois. And it's a monster church. There's like five campuses of this church, 20,000, you know, one of those just amazingly humongous places. But what was really neat was just to see the passion in the people as God's word was proclaimed, just very straightforward, very blunt, very bold. And this guy preaches it that way, has been for years. And so when the band comes up to play, their band is the Vertical Church Band, which is one of the most popular, famous bands in Christian music in the world. And when they get up and sing, it's absolutely wide open, the speakers, you know, just wide open. It's this humongous million square foot place, if you will, and it's wide open, and you could barely hear the band play because the people were singing so passionately, you could almost not hear the band. It was amazing. And what was neat is I was there for this conference, and it's all church planters, people that have planted churches and then are in the pipeline to plant churches through Harvest Bible Fellowship. So during that conference, you'd imagine 2,000 of those people probably pretty fired up. That's their whole life, right? But the neat thing about this church is that when I went on Saturday night just to sit with the people, not the pastors and stuff from all around the world, but just the regular attenders and members of Harvest Bible Chapel, it was the same exact way. When that guy got up and said, all right, let's turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, I'm preaching on one verse 58 tonight, it was like this. The noise of the paper from the Bible, there was 2,000 people there, I guarantee you there were 1,600 Bibles, 1,600 notebooks, and both hands, 4,000 hands to heaven, and every voice fully extended to the max to praise God. It was I looked at Kyle, I said, did you hear it? It wasn't just of a few pages. It was a wave, like you could, it was deafening, the sound of the Bibles opening and turning pages. It was awesome. It was awesome. So I had a great, great experience there, and I'll tell many of you about it as time goes on. It was great. I've told many of you already some of the things that happened, but anyway, it's good to be back. We're going to jump back into our message series called The God of the Mountain and the God of the Valley, experiencing God's presence just everywhere. You know, Psalm 137 says that I can never get away from your presence. Like, that's what the Bible says. It says, I can never get away from your presence. No matter where you go, there you are. Up, down, and all around, there's God. You can't get away from him, no matter if you want to or not. Sometimes that's a good thing because it's comforting, right? But sometimes it's a scary thing because you're misbehaving. You're like, oops. But just know you can't get away from his presence. It's this whole idea of omnipresent God. He's everywhere at every moment all the time. And so there's the reality of that, but some people just don't realize that. And so that's the whole idea of this teaching series, is to make you very, very aware of that truth. This series comes, it's kind of jumped out of this story in 1 Kings chapter 20. I'll bring you back there for a moment and recap it for you in case you weren't here 2 weeks ago. In 1 Kings chapter 20, Israel is in war. Go figure, right? Always at war with somebody. So the Israel is fighting Aram, this country, and so Israel has this king Ahab, and they have the Aram has Ben-Hadad, and they fight this war. And apparently, when we look at the text in 1 Kings, and please check it out when you get a chance. Don't just take my word on it. 1 Kings chapter 20 says that there was a battle and it was up on a hill of some sort, some type of a mountain. I don't know how big the mountain was. It doesn't say what mountain it was. You know, sometimes the Bible says it was on Mount Sinai or Mount Ararat, but this one's just on a mountain. And the opposition gets whooped, right? Israel whoops them. But what happens is Ben-Hadad's guys gather up again and they say, hey, listen, king, let's regather an army because I think we can take them this time. And someone say, bad idea. It was a really bad idea, but they said we could take them this time because the text goes on to tell us why they thought they could take them. So they were a polytheistic culture, and they said to their king, hey, their gods, right? No, but they didn't know any better. Their gods are the gods of the mountains, and that's why they beat us, because we're on a mountain. But they're not the gods of the valleys. So let's regroup some people and we'll get them down in the valley and we'll whoop them. So what's God's response in that text? You can read it. Like I said, he says, no, I'm gonna let you win so that they know I'm not, he doesn't go so that they know I'm the king of the mountain or the god of the valley. He says, I'm gonna let you win so that they know I'm Lord, right? I'm Lord. And so that's what we've been doing. We want to realize that God is the God of the mountain and also the God of the valley. Sometimes it's a literal mountain we're going to climb in Scripture, and sometimes it's a proverbial mountain, and sometimes it's a real, legit valley, and sometimes it's a proverbial valley. We're going to experience all of those things. Last time we talked, we climbed Mount Sinai with Moses, where God, he went up there and God actually spoke, like you could hear the voice, and he gave them their identity. He said, you're going to be my people, and he reminded them how awesome he had been to them, so he encouraged them, and then he gave them the law. I mean, this was a great time. God actually spoke. They could, like, see the cloud. He was very, very present right there. He was the God of the mountain. Then we went down into the proverbial valley where we visited with old Nehemiah. Makes my knees knock just thinking about old Nehemiah, because every time we talk about Nehemiah, crazy things start happening at the church. I don't know what it is about that book, yeah. But Nehemiah was down in a proverbial valley because he was really down and out. Like, his people and the city that he loved had been destroyed, and so he was just in mourning. He was really, really sad. Anyone ever been there before? Just really, really down, and that was Nehemiah. He was in the proverbial valley. But good things happen to him. Read the story of Nehemiah when he goes to his enemy king, who could have killed him at any moment, and he says, hey, can I have all the materials I need to rebuild the city, hence the people that is going to one day rebel against you? Sure, why not? Why wouldn't I, right? So it just said that the reason why it all happened is because the hand of God was on Nehemiah the whole time. So, of course, God visits him in the valley. Well, our mountaintop experience this week is going to actually be in Matthew 17, but the story actually, to really get the proper context of it, you need to go to Matthew 16, and I'm going to start reading there, just so that we can understand what 17 is. 17 is this story of the transfiguration. Many of you have heard of that. It's where Jesus, like, starts glowing, if you will. His face is brighter than one of these spotlights. His clothing is whiter than these pages, and he kind of freaks everybody out. So that's like a really neat story of miraculous happening, but there's some meaning behind the story, more than just the supernatural coolness of Jesus glowing. I'd like to glow. I'd like to glow. Would anyone else like to glow? I think that would be a really cool superhero, if I could be Glow Man. So anyway, in Matthew 16, what's happening, and we'll read there in a minute, but what's happening is that Jesus is going around town, he's performing all these miracles, and so he goes to his disciples, his small group of people, and he says, hey, who do they say that I am? And they rattle off all these different names and stuff, right, of who he could be. This prophet, that prophet, John the Baptist, all that, whatever, and they're all wrong. But then he says the most important thing, and this is a question for you. This is like the most important question you'll ever answer in your entire life. 1,000 years from now, you'll never, ever think of any other question that you answered that mattered except this one. Jesus looks at you and says, who do you think that I am? That's the most important question you will ever, ever entertain. And I hope you make the right answer. And Peter makes the right answer. He finally gets something right. He says, you're the anointed one. You're the Messiah, the Son of the living God. And Jesus is like, yeah, true dat. Yeah, I am. He's like, as a matter of fact, how cool are you, Peter? No one ever even taught you that. This unseen Father, my Father in heaven, actually taught you that. How cool. So he commends the guy, right? I would like it if Jesus commended me personally. Who would like that? I'd like that, right? Would you raise your hand if you'd like that? Jesus come in and say, hey, good job, John. Well done. I'd like that, right? Okay, so that's good. That's good. So now knowing this, that Peter has now said it right out loud, hey, you're the guy. You're the one. You're the one. So immediately following that, here in chapter 16, verse 21, this is where we'll pick up. So now after Peter acknowledges that just Jesus is not just some miracle worker, rabbi, cool, you know, guy who's got a thing going, but he's like the Son of God. He's the anointed one, the Messiah that they've been waiting for forever. And this is what Jesus says. Okay, now you guys get this. He says, from then on, Jesus began to tell his disciples plainly that it was necessary for him to go to Jerusalem and that he would suffer many terrible things at the hands the elders, the leading priests, and teachers of religious law. He would be killed, but on the third day, he would be raised from the dead. But Peter took him aside and began to reprimand him for saying such things. If you look down at the bottom of some of your Bibles, you'll see like an asterisk, and it gives you another possibility of other manuscripts. It doesn't say that he was reprimanding him. It says that he was correcting him. Heaven forbid, Lord, he said, this will never happen to you. Now, we have to pause because you have to realize that just moments before, Peter's acknowledging that this guy is the anointed Son of the living God, right? So if he's the Son of the living God, how could you correct him? How can you correct him? Like, that doesn't work, right? You take your kids aside and you reprimand them for doing good, but if that kid's God, you wouldn't tell him he's doing something wrong, right? So this is what Peter, I just think that's really funny and stupid. So here's, it's kind of nice, it says that heaven forbid that this would happen. Heaven forbid, Lord. Now, If hell is being forever separated from the Lord, then heaven is what? Being forever with the Lord. So he's saying, heaven forbid heaven. I mean, Jesus is heaven. Do you understand what I'm saying to you? He is the reason why heaven is so awesome. Not that you're not crying or have no more mortgage. It's that you get to be with Jesus. That's what makes heaven. So if you can't say heaven forbid heaven, or Lord forbid, Lord, like he is Lord. So he comes up with this plan that this is what's going to happen. And so what happens is he goes from, hey, you get it. You're the Son. You realize you're the Son, that I'm the Son of the living God, the anointed one. Amen, brother. Like, job well done. And just a few sentences later, he says, get away from me, Satan. Like, There's certain times that my wife might do this to me. You guys tracking with me? Certain times where this might happen, but I don't think that it should happen with Jesus, right? Changing his mind that quick, something happens here. Get away from me, Satan. Now, is Peter actually Satan? No. But Satan's working on him, working with him, right? Even Peter. And he says, get away from me, Satan. You're a dangerous trap to me. This is the big part of it. You are seeing things merely from a human point of view, not from God's. And that's really where we need to hang out tonight. See, Jesus, he declares this divine plan, right? He says, this is what's going to happen. I'm going to go to Jerusalem, and I'm going to be tortured and beaten and all, and I'm going to die, and then I'm going to rise up again in 3 days. So he gives his divine plan, but then Peter, yeah, but It sounds like one of your kids, right? Yeah, but, yeah, but, yeah, but, yeah, but. So Peter, let me do this to you. Peter slash you. Jesus gives his divine plan. Hold up your Bible. Come on now. Right? He gives you the divine plan, and we go, yeah, but. Right? Who does that? Who does yeah, but? Don't leave me hanging. Come on now. Right? Yeah, but. See, Jesus gives his divine plan, and we just say, yeah, but here's what I think, God. Yeah, it's bad idea. Bad idea. It's funny how, you know, the Bible, one of our favorite verses on coffee cups and all is that all things work out for the good to those who love the Lord, and then we don't put anything else on the cup because we don't want the second part. We just want all things to work out good for us. Amen? Unfortunately, he says you got to be called to his purpose. Like, so when he says do this and the good things will happen, you kind of can't circumvent the system. I'm just saying, so don't try to. But let's give a little credit to Peter. We have the luxury of hindsight, don't we? So we've now seen what's happened with Jesus. We've now enjoyed the fact that Jesus did what he did, because if you're in this room and you're saved, you get to reap the benefit of this divine plan. But Peter, he didn't understand that. He's living in the moment, right? So let's just kind of put you into the story. And let's get rid of your hindsight. You've seen what's happened now. You know it worked out well. But let's just talk about Peter for a second. Remove the hindsight for a second. Here's Peter. Right? He loves Jesus. They're homies, right? They're taking selfies and stuff. They're hanging out. They're best buds. And he's Jesus is performing miracle after miracle, feeding 5,000 people, curing people, casting out demons, everything. I mean, walking on water, all great stuff, right? So we got crowds growing, momentum's growing, the kingdom of God's advancing. Peter left his whole life behind and said, yeah, Jesus, I'm going with you. So when Jesus says, yeah, I'm gonna get tortured and killed, right? I mean, can you blame Peter for going, hey, yeah, that's not a good plan. Like, I like the way things are going. You made me leave my job, let my family, my fishing nets are out there on the sand getting ruined, and now you're gonna die. Like, this is not working out well for me. I mean, we're all like that, right? I can understand where Peter's coming from. So I would say that's good. That's good that he wouldn't want his best friend to die. Who wants their best friend to die? Don't raise your hand. I don't see Jerome in the room, man. What happened? Because you already killed him. That's awesome. I don't blame Peter for feeling this way. Jesus was his everything at that point. He'd given up his entire life to follow this guy. He totally bought in, all chips in, and now the guy's going to die. Well, that's not going to work out well for me. So I can understand, though. I can agree with him that his plan was a good plan. Like, don't die, Jesus. Let's keep going with this thing. It's rocking now. We're finally getting some traction. Let's go. So it's a good plan. But the Bible tells us that there's no forgiveness of sin without the shedding of blood. So Jesus being tortured, you know, bloodied and killed to pay for the sins of all mankind, and then dying and then rising up again so that we too can rise. That's great. That's great, isn't it? That was a great amen spot. You got it. Listen, you're new. I love when people talk back at me, like in a good way. Woo, Jesus. There's certain churches that really are vocal. I'm not saying I like their church better, any other church better. I just love when people, I love when people take notes, and I love when people like give Jesus a shout out. That's cool. I encourage you to do it. So it's human perspective. Yeah. I don't know who that was, but thank you. Is that you, Josh? Oh. Charles, thank you. So it's human perspective versus divine perspective. Isaiah 53:10, it's always been God's good plan to crush him. That's the divine perspective that we simply don't get. We need a perspective change. Everyone needs a perspective change. That's why it says in Romans 12:2 to let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. You know why? Because stuff happens. What happened to you today? Anything? Tell me one thing that happened to you today. You went to work. Good or bad? It was what? It was good. Who went to work today? Who else went to work today and the work was bad? They didn't enjoy it. Anyone else? Who ever goes to work and doesn't enjoy it and wishes they didn't have to go? Okay. Perspective. You see? Stuff happens, right? You have to work. Everyone has to work. So the question is, what's your perspective on the work? See, that's Christian victory, because Christians and non-Christians both have to work, but Christians can have a proper perspective on work, and when they say, what'd you do today? I worked. It was good. That's victory. See, it's all about perspective. Every week I come in here and I stand up front and I see your faces and I see when you're sleeping and I see when you're on Facebook. I see your faces. I know you. And that's my perspective from up there. I look at you, and you guys sit here, and generally, you all sit in the same seats all the time. I don't know why you do that, but it's all of, my perspective is up there. Now, if I climb up here, and I get up on top of this ladder at the back of the room, and I look at you here, see, I see the same people, just like here, Josh. Here, I don't want to step on your phone. It's the same people, right? But I have a different perspective. I'm coming at you from a different elevation, and I'm coming at you from a different geography. I'm over here instead of up there. But I see the same people, but I have a different perspective on you, don't I? Just like work. He works, you said good, you said bad. You both have to work, different perspective. I got a different perspective. We all have to have a different perspective when it comes to God, or else we're going to stay in the same pit, in the same valley we've been in for a very long time. Who wants to be part of that church? Who wants to be that person that actually follows what God says and says, God wants to change you by changing the way you think and give you a new perspective? Raise your hand. Okay, I want you to do me a favor. Don't be a person that hears the word and doesn't do it. I want you to be the church that shows that you mean it. Go switch your seats right now. If you really care, switch your seat. Get a different perspective. If you're sitting here, go sit over there. If you're sitting here, over there. Change your perspective. Sit in a different place. Quit going to the same place. You go to the same place, you're never going to change. You're always going to be the same. This is awesome. This is awesome. There you go. I love it. There you go. There you go. See, it's already getting better. Let me give you a heads up. If it's dark red, squishy. If it's light red, hard as a rock. See? It's already getting better. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. You know, it's funny. It was about 3.5, maybe 4 years ago. Meredith and I, we bought a motorcycle, and we still have this motorcycle. It's a nice little bike, and it's a Honda Shadow 750. Okay? To some, you might say, well, that's awesome. That's great. That's okay. But you need to know, it's like not much more than a moped, okay? It's a great bike for just cruising around here, which we do, but we did something really stupid. Immediately after buying it, we were like, yeah, let's road trip, you know? And so I threw this little woman on the back of that motorcycle, and we rode all the way up to North Georgia. Like, if you have a Harley, that's cool. If you have a Goldwing, that's cool. If you have a Honda Shadow 750, it's not cool. Unless you like 7.5 hours of as this thing's redlining to go 70, right? It's just really stupid, right? Not only that, but we were so excited about doing it, it was the wrong time of year to do it. So did you guys ever see Dumb and Dumber when the guy's boogers are frozen? You know, and he's like, I gotta pee, just do it, right there, just do it. Because he wanted to get warmed up. That's what it was on the motorcycle. I had my helmet, I had the face mask, I had mittens, scarf, the thing over, you know, like the skier, like the downhill skier guys. I mean, I was bundled up with every jacket and scarf I could, and I was like a frozen solid. We stopped at a hotel that night, and my wife ran me a scalding hot tub, and I just sat in that water and shivered. It was the stupidest idea ever. I will never do that again until I get a different motorcycle. But it was funny. I say that because I'm on this trip, right? Now, anyone ever own a motorcycle in here? Anybody? Okay, so you might know what I'm talking about. I remember being on the road, and I'm going down the road, and my pegs on my bike are probably, I don't know, about that high off the ground. So, I mean, I'm really in no jeopardy of skidding, and you know what I'm saying. But I remember riding along, I don't know where we were on that trip, but I was riding along, and I went like this. Don't do that. Right? Because when you do that, you realize that the road, which is like this, but it seems like it's millimeters from your foot. And of course, vivid imagination, and so, you know, it just looks fuller in here. I like that. So vivid imagination. So I'm just riding along, and of course, I have this thought that my foot, you know, you have the vision, that my toe is going to grab the cement, of course, rip the skin right off my feet, and rip this, and all my tendons are going to come flying out, and I'm just going to fly over the handlebars, and, you know, right across. I mean, I'm having these visions of what's going to happen to me. I mean, you know what I'm saying? Like, it didn't happen, but that's what I'm thinking about, because the road is so close to me. I'm afraid of it. But here's the thing. This past week, I went to Chicago, and I flew. Anyone ever flown before? So when you're up a little ways, that road that was scaring me to death, you know, it's like a string. It's like a line. It's just a little, it's like, if you look at the wood here, see these lines? That's what the road looks like. It's not so scary anymore. Why? Starts with a P. Perspective. Yes, it's your perspective. It's your perspective. So, let's get some perspective. So we see what's happened in chapter 16, right? He says, hey, you're merely thinking from a human point of view. Your perspective is not of God, it's of man. It's very horizontal. It's not very, what? Vertical. And so we read in this transfiguration that Jesus needed to give his disciples a new perspective. And it wasn't just to see him glow. That'd be cool. But there's a lesson here, and I want you to see it. After this happens with Jesus calling Peter Satan, it says 6 days later, so just a week later, Jesus took Peter and the two brothers, James and John, so there's three guys, and he led them up a high mountain to be alone. So I don't know what the name of the mountain was, and I have no clue. I've looked it up. I can't find it. It doesn't matter. It's high, and it's mountain. And so as the men watched, Jesus' appearance was transformed so that his face shone like the sun and his clothes became as white as light. Suddenly, Moses and Elijah appeared and began talking with Jesus. Someone say, freak out. Peter explained, Lord, it's wonderful for us to be here. Duh. If you want, I'll make three shelters, tabernacles, sheds, whatever you want to call it, doesn't matter. I'll make three shelters as memorials, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. But even as he spoke, a bright cloud overshadows them, and a voice from the cloud says, now you should all pay attention because this is the unseen consumable fire, Father God speaking. This is my dearly loved son who brings me great joy. Listen to him. The disciples were terrified and fell face down on the ground. Then Jesus comes over, touches them, says, get up, don't be afraid. And when they looked up, Moses and Elijah, gone, and they saw only Jesus. I need a drink. Good story? It's a great story, but there's more than just a story here. What happens here is God offers these guys clarity. And when you get up on a mountain, you have clarity. You can see clearly. There's nothing in the way, right? You can see properly. And here's the key to this. He said, I brought him up on the mountain to be alone. See, we have to fix our eyes on Christ, the author and finisher of our faith. That's what we're supposed to do. You have to spend time alone with God to have proper perspective on the stuff that's going to happen every single day of your life. If you don't get to know who God is, his character and his nature, when things invade your world, you collapse. You wonder, is there a God? Is he here? Does he hear me? Is he around? Does he answer prayer still? Or is he a God that created everything, got the world spinning and said, okay, I'm done with that. I'm going to go spin another one over here. You need to know who God is or you will collapse. So he offers them clarity by letting them get alone with God. Here's the perspective that he wanted them to have and he wants you to have. Moses and Elijah are two icons of the Jewish faith. Did you know that? Moses is the guy who, after 400 years of slavery in Egypt, God sends Moses to go deliver them, to drag them out of Egypt. Ever heard of the burning bush, the Red Sea that opened, the Ten Commandments, okay? Crazy, the Ten Plagues, crazy stuff. God gave Moses the law that established the Jewish faith to the people. Huge icon in the Jewish faith. And then Elijah, also the other guy that shows up. This is the amazing, powerful mouthpiece for Almighty God, speaking to the people, miracles done through this man. As a matter of fact, I don't know if you guys know this, Peter said that, this is a huge thing. Peter said of Jesus that you're the Messiah. Do you know that the Jewish people think that Elijah is? Do you know that every single year when we had the Passover Seder at my house, some of you knew I'm Jewish, okay, so I did this, the Seder every year. Every year they put the wine glass out on the table, they open the door, if the water moves, they think Elijah's there. He's the Messiah they're waiting on. So you can see that to the Jewish people, these are massive mountain of men, right? Huge icons to the Jewish people. But God himself, God the Father, comes down and clarifies and gives these guys a new perspective. He didn't say anything was wrong with Moses and Elijah. Did he? Did he rip them? Did he say they were good, bad, or indifferent? He said nothing. But what did he do? He spoke. He said, okay, fine, they're good. This guy is my son, my dearly loved son. Listen to him. Now listen, you got to know something. I don't know if you, I'm Jewish, so like I may get this maybe a little bit more than most, but to tell a Jew not to listen to Moses, that's big time. You know what I'm saying? Moses was he's the man. Like other than Jesus, who else in the whole Bible, in the whole biblical narrative is more humongous than Moses? And God saying, don't listen to Moses, listen to this carpenter. That's huge, right? So he gives him a proper perspective. He says, listen, you need to know that Jesus' position trumps even them. Trumps even them. They're good, but Jesus is great. Amen. So the question, like, it's a good story and everything, but what's your Moses? And who or what is your Elijah? See, these are not just good stories. They're here to challenge you. Who is your Moses? What is your Elijah? What has you capped at looking at good instead of busting through that glass ceiling to what is great? That's the challenge that you have to ask yourself. What are your eyes set on? This story here is huge. When we look at the story and we see Jesus on the mount with these guys, they're in such awe of Almighty God's voice, they fall on their face, right? And Jesus walks up to him and he says, get up, don't be afraid. And what happens when they get up? Don't just think that the words are random. Listen. When they got up, all they saw was Jesus. Singular focus, friends. Singular focus. That's what we must fix our eyes on. Jesus Christ, the Lord. And when you fix your eyes on Jesus, you don't have to be afraid. When you fix your eyes on the one who conquers sin and death and disease, you don't have to fear those things, do you? When you fix your eyes on the lover of your soul and you realize that love covers sin and love conquers sin and hatred, and if you see that love expels all fear, why would you fear? So we can walk through the valley of the shadow of death and not fear. Why? Because Jesus is with me. I'm good. I'm good. So on the mountaintop, God shows up and he changes their perspective. So he is certainly the God of the mountain, of a real, physical, dirt and rock and sand and trees, mountain. He shows up on it, not just so they can get up on the top and see clearly, but that they could see clearly. Amen? Okay. So God wants to give us a different perspective, but sometimes he doesn't give us a new perspective on a mountain. Sometimes he gives us a new perspective. Where at? In the valley. So can I take you down deep into a valley? Can I take you down deep? Paul says in Philippians 3:10, I want to share in the suffering so I can share in the resurrection. The same guy, inspired by God's Spirit, says in Romans 8:17, if you share the suffering, you will also share the glory. So let's go down into the valley, into the darkest of darks, into a darker place than you've ever been before. And I want to share something with you as it gets darker and darker and darker and darker and darker. And I wait for my internet to come on so I could read. Hey, buddy, I'm reading scripture. I'm super holy. Super, super holy. Do you already see me squinting when the lights were all on? It's getting pretty bad, actually, lately. I gotta go back to my cheaters here. Yeah, that's exactly what I need. Like, your family's ever gonna... Well, Jared's not here, so he won't make fun of me wearing women's glasses. But Michael will tell him, so... All right, so let's take you to a deep, deep proverbial valley. A place where you've never, ever been this low, okay? Acts chapter 16, verse 16. One day as we, the disciples, and it's Paul and Silas and then others. It doesn't say we. Some of the disciples. One day, as we were going down to the place of prayer, we met a slave girl who had a spirit that enabled her to tell the future. She earned a lot of money for her masters by telling fortunes. So she was like a fortune-telling hooker, if you will. These guys are pimping this chick out to go make money for them. This is what's happening. And she follows Paul and the rest of us, and she's shouting, quote, "These men are servants of the Most High God, and they have come to tell you how to be saved." Let me ask you a question. Is that true? It is, right? Good? Okay. I agree. This went on day after day until Paul got so exasperated. We were looking at human perspective, good, versus divine perspective, which is what? Great, right? You said it was good. This went on day after day. "These men are servants of the Most High God, and they will have come to tell you how to be saved." Good. This went on day after day until Paul got so exasperated that he turned and said to the demon, wait a minute, wasn't she telling the truth? What do you mean, demon? Oh, so the devil doesn't come with horns and a pitchfork, right? He comes what? As a woman. You ever wonder why he's not married yet? It's amazing. Yeah, that'll get you somewhere. But it was funny. That there was funny. Amen. Yeah. Edit. No, okay. This is when we name our church something different for the film. I can't believe this goes on at the Presbyterian Church. Love you, Leon. Sorry. Okay. So he says to the demon within her, "I command you in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her," and instantly it left her. So keep the lights off. So the point is here is that good can go bad in a hurry. When good trumps great. See, what was great was that they wanted people to get saved. What's not great is that she's yelling out the truth necessarily, but what's great is that the truth goes forth and resonates in a heart, and people get saved and regenerated. And this truth was getting in the way of that. And so he says, demon, be out. So it's not always good just because it seems like it. That's why the Bible says that the devil comes disguised as an angel of light. Beautiful. Okay, so as her master's hopes of wealth were now shattered, so they grabbed Paul and Silas and dragged them before the authorities at the marketplace. The whole city, this is quotes, the whole city is in an uproar because of these Jews. They're always picking on us. They still do. They shouted to the city officials, they are teaching customs that are illegal for us Romans to practice. A mob quickly formed against Paul and Silas, and the city officials ordered them stripped and beaten with wooden rods. Now, hold on a second. You can read that, right? You can read the words that they were stripped. Now, it doesn't say if they were stripped down to kind of declothed or if they were stripped naked, but let's not just assume. I've read the Bible. You guys have read the Bible, right? Let's never assume the least happen, because it just never seems to go that way in Scripture, does it? No. They were stripped. I would say, and it's not Scripture. It's me over here conjecture saying they were stripped naked and they were beaten with rods. Now, I did this because you can't. Sometimes you read the Bible and you read through those words and it just doesn't seem like well, you know. You just read, like it says, I'm the Lord thy God. Okay, that's good. But then it says they were stripped and beaten with wooden rods. You just blow by that too. Without realizing what really happened. Do you know what I'm saying? That's why we watch movies like The Passion of Christ, to get at least a glimpse of the reality of him absorbing the wrath of your sin. Right? So that's why you got to understand what it's like to get beaten with a wooden rod. Anyone ever been there? No. They were, listen. This probably not a good time to be laughing. They were severely beaten, and then they were thrown into prison. The jailer was ordered to make sure they didn't escape, so the jailer put them into the inner dungeon and clamped their feet in the stocks. So, you can put the lights on. So, although I like that. So that's pretty bad, right? Anyone ever been there? You know, in our country, it's like, rats, my AC in my car's not working. Where are you, Lord? I won't do it again. So it's really bad. They were stripped naked, beaten severely, and thrown into the inner dungeon. Okay, so I'm pausing here. I'm slowing down here because you need to understand the depths of the valley that these guys are in. Inner dungeon means it's not with a window view. Inner dungeon means there's no like pleasant, were you outside today, the pleasant breeze? Paul and Silas weren't feeling that on their skin. They're in the inner dungeon with no window view, no breeze, probably in some, like they didn't have toilets, so feces and rats, like it wasn't a good place, was it? It was a deep, deep valley. Now listen, when you come to church, we're to come to encourage one another. You're not here just to listen to me. You guys realize this, right? Although that's what happens in church a lot. But listen, we are here to encourage one another. So I've been up here and I'm doing my thing, right? I need you to encourage me. When you come to church, you want to hear from God, don't you? Do you want to hear from me or do you want to hear from God? You want to hurt my feelings. God, right? Less Moses, more Yahweh, right? Okay. When you hear him about to speak to you, I'm going to say something. When you hear him start to talk to you, I want to hear it. Okay? I want to know. I want to hear when God starts to speak to you because he's about to show up in the jail. He's about to show up in the jail. It says that the jailer put them into the inner dungeon. right? Did you catch that? No, did you really catch that? He put them into the inner dungeon. See, the devil screwed up. He might have put their feet in stocks, but he put them into the dungeon. When two or more are gathered in his name, guess who shows up? Yeah. You see, you can't do that, right? He showed up in the jail. Jesus showed up in the valley. Now here's some more perspective for you. Ready? I want to tell me when you hear it. These guys were free before they were free. Do you hear? They were free before they were free, and you can be also. Because you may feel like you're in some type of a valley, or maybe you feel like you're in jail too. But remember something. Remember we said Psalm 139:7, I can't get away from your presence. Here's some more verses for you. Galatians 5:1. It is for freedom that Christ has set us free. John 8:36, whom the Son sets free. Here's the one for you though. 2 Corinthians 3:17, where the Spirit of the Lord is what? There is freedom. See, these guys, they knew that they were free because Christ had set them free because he put his Spirit in them. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Do you see the perspective change? Some of us can go to jail, Eric, right? But there was a time when you're in jail that you don't feel like you're in jail anymore, right? Because the Spirit of the Lord is in him, and it didn't matter what was where he was, he's free. The doors don't matter anymore. It's all perspective, you see. It's all perspective. So location means nothing. Circumstances mean what? Nothing. The devil might put your feet in chains, but that doesn't mean you can't raise your hands, right? The devil might have put your feet in chains, but it doesn't mean you can't raise your voice, right? So if the Spirit of the Lord is in you, Ephesians 1:13 said, at the moment of your conversion, God put his Spirit in you. So it doesn't matter about the chains that you're in or the dungeon that you're in, you can still raise your hands. And you could still raise your voice and praise him in this storm, and I will lift my hands, right? You could still do that. Doesn't matter where you are. And here's the other thing. It says that in the scriptures that God inhabits the praises of his people. So, let me read on. This is awesome. Come on, phone. So around midnight, Paul and Silas, who understand this now, and God wants you to understand this. Around midnight, remember what just happened. I won't hit this again, but you know what happened to him, right? Now, let me ask you, I won't hit, but if you were that pallet just now, how many of you would be in a good mood? I mean, let's, a moment of truth in church. How many people would be going, praise God that he just beat me with this stick? Probably not. And your pastor, same thing. I'd like to say I was like super holy. What's wrong with you guys? You wouldn't be praising? Whatever, right? Around midnight, so not only have they been beaten and stripped and humiliated and put in an inner dungeon, but it's late and they're probably tired. Okay? Ministry like this is really going to tire you out. You know, so they were praying. I could see that. It's like if I got whipped, I could be praying. Who would be praying? Lord, please get that guy away from me so he doesn't beat me again. I could do that. But how about the next part? And singing hymns. Very strange, right? Very strange. But they were. Why? Because they realized they were free. They were free. They were singing hymns to God, and the other prisoners were listening. Your witness is huge, guys. Your witness is, when you go through hell, let them see that you're still in heaven. Suddenly, so the other prisoners were listening. Suddenly, there was a massive earthquake, and the prison was shaken to its foundations. All the doors immediately flew open, and the chains of every prisoner fell off. The jailer woke up to see the prison doors wide open. He assumed the prisoners had escaped, because if they opened, who would escape? Me. Yes, yes, I'd be out of there so fast, as long as my busted leg could run after he beat me with it. So he's seen that he assumed that they escaped, so he drew his sword to kill himself. So just so you'll know, in those times, if you're in a post and you fail, they kill you. So rather die on your own than have them torture and kill you. But Paul shouted to him before he kills himself, to the guy who's got him in jail, who we all said we would run. Paul says, "Stop! Don't do this. Don't kill yourself. We are all here." Crazy. The jailer called for lights, ran to the dungeon with his torch, I guess, and fell down trembling before Paul and Silas. Then he brought them out and asked, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" Man, a witness. When times are in hell, if you can show them you're still seated securely in heaven, this is what happens. They replied, the disciples, "Believe in the Lord Jesus and you'll be saved along with everyone in your house." Not like I can get saved from my kids, but everyone in your house has this opportunity as well. And they shared the word of the Lord with him and with all who lived in the house. See, there's the verify what I just said. Everyone has to hear it. Everyone has to believe in their own. Even at that hour of the night, the jailer cared for them and washed their wounds. Then he and everyone in his household was immediately baptized. Awesome, awesome story. So, this is what I want to show you. Let's bring this thing out here a second. Psalm 139:7 says that you can't get away from God. He's everywhere, right? Okay, so here we are in church. Little cross. And God's everywhere, right? I can't even spell God. It's so bad. He's everywhere. You guys get what I'm saying right here? He's just like everywhere. He's floating around, spirit, consuming fire, not to make light, but he's just kind of everywhere, right? We know that. Then it says in Ephesians 1:13 that when you bowed the knee to Christ, he put his spirit in you, right? You're here in church, right? So here we are in church. I don't know who that is, but I'm thinking it's Michael. And so God's here, right? Because Michael's here, right? Right? Who else? Well, here's Daisy right over here. There's Daisy right here, but she's got longer hair, right? But look, she's got God in her too, right? That's pretty awesome. Oh, here's John. Here's John. He definitely has no hair, but he's got glasses. That's the worst glasses ever. But look, he's happy and smiling. Why is he happy and smiling? Because he has God in him. Yay! Right? So we have omnipresent God, but then look, the Spirit of God is in each person, so he's here even more because God's in them, right? So that's awesome. But look, when two or more are gathered in his name, right, he's there with them even more, right? Even more. And then when it says that God inhabits the praises of his people, so when people start praising God, right, then God's like super all over the place. The reason why I'm saying this is that don't ever settle for omnipresence when manifest presence is available. Okay? Don't ever settle for that. There's no reason to just settle for the fact that he's floating around everywhere, okay? Don't settle for it. The Bible says, "Oh, that you would rend the heavens and come down, that the mountains might quake in your presence." And these guys in the jail, they called down God, and it's exactly what happened. It said that there was a massive earthquake. When he inhabits the praises and comes down, the earth shakes like crazy, and that's exactly what happened, and that's exactly what we need to have in our country right here and right now. And Jesus said in Luke 4, what does he say? "I came to set the captives and the oppressed free." And what happened? They called down God. He came. And what does it say? That the chains of who fell off? Everyone, not just them. Every single person was affected because of the praises of God's people, and he ripped open the heaven, came down and shook the earth and set the captives free. I love it when the Bible comes true in real life. That's exactly what happened. But some people might say, well, you say that, but I don't feel like singing. Sing anyway. I don't like that song. Sing it anyway. You want something to happen in your life? He tells you, sing and I'll come down. Well, I don't want to, you ever hear this one? I don't want to raise my hands. Okay, other than the fact that the scriptures say that when people gather, I want men praying to me with holy hands lifted high, right? So if obedience isn't enough, Jesus said, if you want to live, you have to die. What does that mean? I surrender, God. What does that mean? Put your hands up. I surrender, right? That's what we do. We put our hands up. Lift your hands. Praising God, God's Spirit in us gives us the ability to praise God. You can't even praise God without him in you. You can ask him to come in and start, but you can't praise him without him in you. But at the same time, praising God births freedom's experience. Are we tracking? Do you get what I'm saying to you? You can't experience the freedom until you start the praising. That's what you have to do. You have to start praising. Now, here's the next thing. And you'll see it back in the text of Acts 16. Now that I have lights on, I don't preach short for you new people, so just deal with it. I've been waiting 2 weeks for this. I'm not letting you off easy. Stats say that most people don't read their Bible. This might be the only Bible you read all week, so I'm going for it. It says that the earth quaked, right? And every prisoner's chains fell off. So your praise and your perspective affect me. Look at your neighbor for a second. And try this. Hold on a second. Try this. Look at him. Let me see your wart. Remember, see that? What was that movie? Was it Full Metal Jacket? Bad movie. Don't watch it. Right? But let me see your war face. Let me see it. Come on. Give me some war face. Arr, give me your war face. That's not a war face. His. He's smiling at me. Give me a war face. Oh, yeah. Mandy's got a war face. Then let me see a war face. Arr, no. Look at your neighbor with your war face and go, you affect me. Come on. You affect me. Now, Jared's going to be our model right here because he smiles pretty. Look at your same neighbor with a smile on your face and go, you affect me. Isn't the second one better? I'm glad the camera's back there, dude. Oh, my goodness. That was awesome. My heavens, I love this church. If you want people to love your Jesus, if you want people to fill the seats to your left and right, that's how it happens. It's your perspective. It's your perspective. They see you praising in the storm, that's going to cause them to wonder, and they're going to want to come to this Jesus that you hold so dearly to yourself. Paul and Silas praised, and everyone around them was affected. But there's one more last thing here that I need to show you. Not yet. Not yet. But remember this, that you need to, I was talking to Jessica behind you. Your freedom that you got is attached directly to your purpose. See, the scriptures say that everything was created by him and for him. Jesus, Matthew 28, now go make disciples of all the nations, baptize them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. I think it was 1 Corinthians says, or 1st or 2nd, I can't recall. Email me if you don't think if you think I should know and I don't, but it says that God has chosen us to be his agents of reconciliation, that he's making his plea through us. So there's your purpose. Your purpose is to advance the kingdom of God. It's the reason why you take in another breath. And your freedom is directly attached to that purpose. We saw that in our teaching through Joshua in chapter 1 and then chapter 22, where it said that those tribes, Gad, Reuben, and the half-tribe of Manasseh, are not allowed to enjoy the fullness of their peace and their salvation, if you will, until they go and help others to achieve that same thing. Then you can come back and enjoy it all. And it's the same thing for our freedom. It's not for you. It's for other people. When Christ has set you free, it's not for you. It's for other people. Galatians 5:13, you have been called to live in freedom. Use your freedom to serve one another in love. That's what your freedom is for. That's what your freedom is for. So, you look back at the text in verse 27 and 28. They could have been free. They could have run and enjoyed the deliverance of God. The jailer woke up to see the prison doors wide open. He assumed the prisoners had escaped. So he drew his sword to kill himself, but Paul shouted to him, "Stop! Don't kill yourself. We are all here. What must I do to be saved?" They stuck around, risked being whipped and beaten again if caught. Why? Because they knew their purpose. They had been given God's Spirit and they were set free to accomplish a purpose. And if that meant get whipped and beaten to accomplish that purpose, they're in. And my challenge to you, are you in? Are you in on God's purpose? He created you and he saved you for this purpose, to put forth the gospel that the kingdom of God might advance, period. That's it. That's why we're here. That's why we're here. My freedom is to be used for others to be free. So in closing, I just say to you that God showed up on the mountain. He showed up on the mountain for Peter and for James and for John to give them a new perspective. And what was the perspective? Get your eyes on Jesus. Get your eyes on Jesus. Maybe someone in this room tonight is needs to hear that. Maybe their feelings are hurt because of something, right? You know why your feelings are hurt? Because you're thinking about your feelings. Yeah. And I've said this before, I'll say it again. You can never get your feelings hurt if you're not thinking about your feelings. You got to get your eyes on Jesus. God shows up in the valley for Paul and for Silas for, again, perspective, right? What's the perspective? Well, first of all, you got to get alone with God. And some of us need to hear that. We're not spending adequate time alone with our Savior. We need more time. We need to set our eyes on Jesus. The scriptures tell us in Hebrews that the question is, how do we run the race with perseverance, the race that God has set before us? We do it by fixing our eyes on Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, and to get them off of distractions. So if you're in a deep valley, you gotta do what they did in the jail. You gotta call God down. You gotta call him down and let him rend the heavens like an aggressive ripping open of the heavens and come down, that the mountains might quake in your presence so the shackles are off of our feet. That's what we need to do. So, this is what I want to do with you. Usually we take communion, but I'm not going to do that tonight. We're going to close and we're going to pray. I'm going to pray for you and I want you to pray with me. But then I'm going to give you the chance. If you're on the mountaintop right now, things are good. Anyone? Things are good. Some of us, things are good, right? Praise him. Get your eyes on Jesus and praise him. Don't thank your job. Don't thank your country. Don't thank your parents. Don't thank your wife, your husband. Thank Jesus, right? That's what we do on the mountain. Fix our eyes on Jesus. But I have a feeling, since our country is the most Prozac country in the world, that many of us are down here, right? We're in the valley. But when you're in the valley, when you're in the prison and you feel beaten up, right, and defeated, and you wonder where God is, he's just above the cloud waiting to rend the heavens and come down. So that's what you need. When they sing, I don't even know what they're going to sing, but when they sing, right, they're going to sing a song. Remember Paul and Silas. They prayed, which we're going to do, and they sang, and when they did, what happened? Heaven came down and busted open the jail door, right? So listen, we raise our hands. The devil might have your feet in chains, but we raise our hands. Don't be afraid. It's a house of love. No one's going to shame you or shun you for raising your hands. And then we sing. He might have your feet in shackles, but he doesn't have your hands in chains, and he has nothing on your vocal cords. So begin to praise him and let heaven come down. So here, bow your heads with me for just a moment, and we'll start by praying, and then we'll sing. I want to start by praying God's word for you, over you, to him. It's going in every direction. It's an awesome, awesome little section of scripture. Many people may not be familiar with it. It's in a very rarely read book of the Bible. It's in Habakkuk. What's that? Well, it's in there. And he's what they call a minor prophet. It's just the length of the book, not the power of his words. But this prophet of God, things weren't going well in his day. But these were his words. Now God speaks to an agricultural society back then, and many of us in here, most of us are not farmers, but I'm sure when you hear these words, you'll know exactly what's being spoken. And you can relate if you're in the valley. Habakkuk 3:17, even though the fig trees have no blossoms and there are no grapes on the vines, even though the olive crop fails and the fields lie empty and barren, even though the flocks die in the fields and the cattle barns are empty, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will rejoice in the God of my salvation. Father, that's what we're asking. Father, I know that there's many people in this room, including myself, that have had some really, really difficult times as of late. It seems like our life is a series of mountaintops and valleys, and some of us are experiencing valley experiences right now. They're not day trips, they're extended stay Americas, and it's painful. But Lord, we want to have the same spirit that Habakkuk had, that even though there's no money in the bank, even though our car is broken, even though our kids are prodigals, even though there's addictions in our families, even though there's divorce, even though people are sick, people that we love are dying or have died, even though we put on the news and we see the world just seems like it's coming to an end, like we're on this downward spiral. Even though, we realize that that spirit that raised Christ from the dead lives in us. And we don't have to feel oppressed by the stuff that's going on. We want to live a life that exalts you. We want to live a life that shows that in a relationship with the Creator, stuff can happen, yet we will rejoice in the God of our salvation. And so, Lord, as we get ready to sing right now, I ask you, Father, if I have found any favor with you at all, I pray that you would inspire every person in this room, those that are normally too shy, to lift their hands and lift their voices, to give them, just fill them with your spirit so that they can do that, so they can experience something that they've never experienced before, the heavens being rend and God coming down to minister to them. So, Lord, we thank you for tonight's message. I thank you, Lord, that you've given me the joy and the privilege of spending this time with these beautiful people. Thank you, Lord Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
It's like the light of the day and the cool of the night, the sun and the moon and the stars that are bright. He's there, right where you are. He's there, right where you are.